Our featured speaker tonight, Colonel Alan West, was born and raised in Atlanta, Georgia. He comes from a family with a long tradition of military service. During his 22-year career in the U.S. Army, Colonel West served in Operation Desert Storm, Operation Iraqi Freedom, and Afghanistan. He's received numerous military honors, including a Bronze Star and 3 Meritorious Service Medals. After his retirement in the Army in 2004, Colonel West taught high school for a year. My recollection of high school is this could easily have been a more dangerous assignment than any of the combat zones in which he served. Having survived his high school teaching experience, he returned to the relative safety of Afghanistan as a civilian military advisor to the Afghan Army. Upon returning from Afghanistan, Colonel West ran for Congress in 2008, lost by 10 points, ran again in 2010 in a rematch against the same opponent, and this time won by 10 points, a 20-point swing. I recall seeing a couple of YouTube videos of Colonel West at about this time. In one video, he was enthusiastically exhorting a Tea Party crowd to fix bayonets and charge the enemies of freedom. This was an intense speech. I think the word firebrand was invented for just such oratory. In another video, he was quieting a heckler with a scholarly rundown of the major battles between Western and Islamic civilization between 600 and 1400 AD. I thought to myself, this guy's a little unusual, someone to watch. After his term in Congress ended, Colonel West took up honest work. He's currently a Fox News contributor. Seems like Fox gets all the good ones these days. No wonder they're crushing their competition. He's also a senior fellow at the London Center of Policy Research, and he serves as the president of the National Center for Policy Analysis. Colonel West continues to have an intense and loyal following among Tea Party and conservative faithful, in large part for his blunt and unapologetic defense of individual liberty in the face of the progressive onslaught of the past 6 years, or 25 years, depending on how you count. I have many friends who would love to see him on a conservative dream team as Senator, Secretary of the Army, Secretary of Defense, Vice President, or even at the top of the ticket. I told you were among friends here. Some years ago, Colonel West wrote a regular column for the Atlas Shrugs blog, edited by one of our past speakers, Pamela Geller. I'm going to paraphrase here from one of his early columns. There are Americans who will hate their own country, regardless of the self-evident truth that life just does not get any better than this. And if you truly hate America so much, you're free to find another home. There is surely an illegal immigrant who would be happy in yours. Please help me welcome an American hero who clearly loves his own country, Colonel Alan West.
Thank you very much. And okay, just so you know, everything I'm going to say is written on 1 5x8 index card. But I want to tell you, it really is a pleasure and an honor to be able to travel all across this great country that we call home, this constitutional republic, these great United States of America, and to share thoughts, perspectives, and insights with people who are really concerned about the future and the legacy that they're going to pass on to subsequent generations. And we cannot be that first generation of Americans that leaves less to our children and grandchildren than what was left to each and every one of us. And when I think about the sacrifices that my father, Herman West Sr., made, born in 1920 in Ozark, Alabama, jumped the Chattahoochee River, grew up in Cuthbert, Georgia. My mother, some of you all know her nickname, Snooks West, Elizabeth Thomas West, who grew up in Fort Valley, Georgia, born in 1931. Those were not easy times for them. But the thing is this, they taught me as a young man that I live in the greatest nation that the world has ever known. And my father, a World War II veteran, who went and fought for this great nation at a time when this great nation did not afford him all the rights and privileges, liberties and freedoms that it did other citizens. All he ever said to me that was the most important thing was that there's no greater honor than wearing the uniform of the United States of America. And when he sat down and said, there's only one thing that I want and your mom want and Lance Corporal Herman West Jr. want, we want to see the first officer in our family. And that's how we build a legacy in our families of service and of sacrifice and of commitment. And that's not to say that you have to have a family to serve in the military, but you have to tell the story of the United States of America. You have to tell the story of the great accomplishments in 238 years that we have seen, the stories of our founding fathers and what they have bequeathed to us. Because I truly believe that the greatest title in the world other than Christian is America. So like I said, tonight I'm going to take some time to talk to you about why I believe, without any doubt, and it's irrefutable, that conservative principles and values will restore this great nation. We just need to have men and women that understand what they are and are willing to courageously go out and with steadfast and loyal resolve, stand up for those principles and values. Now, one of the things I always tell people, you got to be a happy warrior. That's why I kind of make jokes and everything like that, because the other side wants you to be down. The other side wants you to be dejected. The other side wants you to be despondent. All those D words, because D words come from the devil. We aren't about the D words that come from the devil. We're about being, as God told Joshua, to be strong and courageous. For the Lord thy God shall never leave you nor forsake you. And he told him that four times in Joshua chapter 1. So I'm here to tell you that. Do it with a smile on your face. Be strong and courageous. Because the battle and the victory is ours. It may seem dark right now, but as it says in the Bible, joy cometh in the morning, and the morning is coming. Ronald Reagan, the former great governor that you had, the great president that we had, he talked about mourning in America. That moment is coming, ladies and gentlemen. So don't ever believe that the days, the greatness of America is over. I believe that our greatest days are coming. But see, the problem that we have on our side is that we want to go out and have these overly intellectual conversations with people too often. We want to go out and try to get the American people to understand what quantitative easing is. And see, Joe and Jay Sixpack, they don't give a daggum about quantitative easing. They just want to know what I can do to be a productive citizen. They want to know what I can do to make sure that I can pass on a better dream for my children and grandchildren. And so what we have to do is we have to be very concise, and we have to be very appropriate and telling of the story and the principles and values that we believe in. You know, those of you who are serving in the military, raise your hand. God bless you and thank you for your service. But I will never forget the time as a young second lieutenant in the airborne over in Vicenza, Italy. I thought I had this great briefing all prepared. And I was rattling off all these facts, figures, all this kind of stuff we were going to do. I was an artilleryman. We're in the numbers. And my commanding officer looked at me and he said two words that meant the world to me and it shaped my thought. He said, so what? And you can just imagine. Here I'm, this young lieutenant, spent all night making this briefing, and I just was crushed. But see, this is what is happening on our side. We're standing up and we're having these so-called conversations with the American people, and the American people are turning and saying, so what? Because the other side is saying free. And we're saying quantitative easing. And so which side do you think they lean towards? So when you talk about the five fundamental principles and values of conservative thought, when you talk about limited government, when you talk about fiscal responsibility, when you talk about individual sovereignty, free market, free enterprise system, and strong national defense, you got to make that mean something to people. You have to pass the so what test. And so that's what I want to try to do with you all tonight. See, the first thing about limited government, why is limited government so important? Because first of all, that's how we were established. Too often, so many people, so many Americans, so many conservatives have never sat down and read the entire Declaration of Independence. Because if you read the entire Declaration of Independence, you can understand that we were talking about onerous and intrusive government. We were talking about breaking the shackles of what England and Britain was doing to us. And so the basic core of who we are, the basic core that says the inalienable rights of the American citizen, the individual, it was an incredible thought that Thomas Jefferson put forth, that they come from your creator. Nowhere else in the world had that thought, that premise, that principle ever been put forth. Because previous to that, it was what you call divine rights theory, which meant that some guy, some gal, a queen, a king, a duke, a duchess, or whatever, they were the ones that were able to grant you your rights and your freedoms, because they were the ones that had this connection to God Almighty. But what Thomas Jefferson said in these great United States of America, as we prepare for our independence, every single person has the ability to have a connection. Every single person has that right to life, to liberty, to the pursuit of happiness, because that comes from your creator. It does not come from man. And because the day that we begin to believe that man is the grantor of our rights, man will also be the taker of those rights. And see, we missed a moment that we should have really illuminated the American people on in 2012 at the Democratic National Convention, when they had to vote to put God back into their platform. Because if you remove God, you remove the creator, then who is the grantor and taker of your rights? You don't have limited government anymore. As a matter of fact, if you don't have God, you will not have life, liberty, and a pursuit of happiness. You have a man that believes they can guarantee your happiness. And that's the difference. That's why they wanted us to have a government that was limited. That's why the words of the Declaration transitioned to the words of the Constitution, and the U.S. Constitution is a restraining document on what the federal government is able to do. And that's why you had to have those first 10 amendments, which were the Bill of Rights. Not the Bill of Collective Rights, not the Bill of Group Rights, the Bill of Individual Rights. And those last two amendments, the 9th and 10th, said that all of those powers not enumerated to the federal government goes down to the state and to the individual. That's what people have to understand. It's because, as my mother taught me, self-esteem only comes from doing esteemable things. And an onerous and invasive government cannot do esteemable things for you. But what an onerous and invasive government, which believes in a guarantee of happiness, will try to tell you that they can provide for your welfare. They can give you a house. They can give you a check. They can do all of these things for you. And then what happens after that is, if you don't have a limited government, then it's no longer fiscally responsible. Because as a government believes that it can guarantee your happiness, guess what it has to be able to do? It has to be able to follow up on those promises. And that's why you continue to see free this and free that. But Alexis de Tocqueville, in 1830, in the book Democracy in America, he talks about the day when our government would no longer be fiscally responsible. When he said a democracy cannot exist as a permanent form of government. It can only exist until a time that the people, the voters, realize that they can vote their own largesse from the public treasury. From that moment on, people will always vote for the person that will promise them the most benefits, with the ensuing result being the collapse of the democracy over loose fiscal policy, resulting in a dictatorship. You tell me we're not on the cusp of what Alexis de Tocqueville talked about, because we're starting to get away from that belief that government is supposed to be limited. And if government is not going to be limited, then government will grow. And if government is going to grow, government then cannot be fiscally responsible. And if government is not fiscally responsible, government then is usurping the most important resource that the American person, the American citizen has, and that is what you carry in your pocket. And see, that leads to the third point, which is individual sovereignty. We don't believe in groups. We don't believe in collectives. We believe in the preeminence of the individual and the Creator God and the individual rights that you are being given, your liberty. Your liberty is broken down into three things: your personal liberty, your economic liberty, and your religious liberty. And if we do not stand up and fight for those three parts of individual sovereignty, of individual liberty, then it won't be long before we don't have these great United States of America. Because it's very simple. If people have economic liberty, guess what they're able to do with their lives? They're able to take care of their families. They're able to plan. When you think about this last State of the Union address, when the president stood up and said, I will be the one that will decide you will get 2 years of free community college. Now, is that pursuit of happiness or is that guarantee of happiness? Is that respecting the individual? Is that limited government? Is that going to be fiscally responsible? Does that promote your individual sovereignty? But how was he going to pay for this? It's very simple. The 529 college student loan program, which is a tax-free program, which the individual, which parents can set money aside so they're the ones that can provide for the future, for the education of their children. He was going to tax that. See, that's what happens when government is not limited. Government will then not be fiscally responsible. Government will then not respect you as the individual and the decisions that you're supposed to be making for your own welfare, for your own life, liberty. See, that's what happens when we sit and we don't understand the fundamental conservative principles and values that the founding fathers left for us today. When I think about here in Silicon Valley, Silicon Valley is not the result of progressive socialism. Okay. Silicon Valley is the result of constitutional conservatism. Because Silicon Valley is a place where we trusted the individual. And in trusting the individual, we trusted the free marketplace. Because if the individual has the resources to be able to have economic freedom, then the individual can invest. And the individual can take their own ingenuity and they can create things. They can be innovative. Silicon Valley is not the result of an onerous government. And when the government does try to believe that it can get involved in the free marketplace and the free enterprise of ideas, when the government all of a sudden believes that it can be a venture capitalist, then the government is no longer limited. And the government will not be fiscally responsible. Because the government will all of a sudden believe that they can take your money and go out and invest it. Isn't it funny how we all of a sudden hear all of these progressive socialists talk about where you need more money for government investments? We need greater investments in government. The next time one of your great leftist representatives here has a town hall, which probably would be by the time I die, but the next time they have a town hall and they talk about government investments, I want you to ask them one simple question. What is the rate of return on a government investment? Ask them, when was the last time that I got a dividend check from the government? See, government doesn't invest. When government is not limited, government is not fiscally responsible. When government is not fiscally responsible, they do not respect you as an individual and your sovereignty. And therefore, government does not respect the free marketplace of ideas. Think about how in 2012, in Roanoke, Virginia, someone stood up and said, if you own a business, you didn't build that. Now we laugh, but that is the most antithetical statement to who we are as an American people. In 238 years, the government did not build this great nation. When people sought to extend this great nation westward and cross the Mississippi River, I don't recall our forefathers and foremothers stopping at the Mississippi River and saying, who's going to build us a bridge? Who's going to feed us? Whatever happened to the rugged, individual, indomitable American entrepreneurial spirit is being crushed by the people in Washington, D.C. They believe that they can guarantee happiness. They don't believe that you have the right to pursue your happiness. They believe that they are the ones that can come in with crony capitalism and they can be venture capitalists. They can wastefully spend your money like they did on this Solyndra crap out here in California. Everywhere you go, where the onerous programs of government have been, you see failure. When you look at Baltimore, Maryland is the result of 50 years, 50 years, 1965 to 2015, Lyndon Johnson, Great Society programs, war on poverty, almost $40 trillion. And look at the inner city. Look at the amount of poverty that we still have. Look at the amount of people on EBT cards. You don't know what an EBT card? Electronic benefit transfer card. Now you don't even have to qualify. You don't even have to say. You just get a card. The government basically gives you money that you can spend anywhere. Drive out when you leave here tonight and see all of the places that are accepting EBT cards. This is what happens when government believes they can guarantee it happens. See, I grew up in the inner city. And the thing that I saw in my neighborhood were mothers and fathers. 50 years later, in the inner city, 72% out of wedlock birth rate for black children. Because the government believed that it did not have to be limited. The government believed it did not have to be fiscally responsible. The government believed that it could guarantee happiness. The government believed that it could give a check to a woman that had a child out of wedlock. And they stipulated by saying, as long as she keeps the man out of a home, she will continue to get a check from the government. Everyone was cheering and clapping a couple of weeks ago when that young black mother went out and slapped her son upside the head about being out there. Time out, coach. Yeah. Where was the dad? See, the government with its unintended consequences, they said, oh, we're going to do a great thing. We're going to provide this check. Look at what has happened today. Black men don't have to be responsible anymore. They don't have to be accountable. The government is coming to homes and it's replaced them by providing a check to the mother. The government has become the sugar daddy. That's progressive socialism. You can find it in Oakland. You can find it in South Central LA. You can find it in my neighborhood in Atlanta. You can find it in Chicago. You can find it in Washington, D.C. We have to be able to tell those stories. We have to be able to talk about those facts. We have to be able to show people, as my mother said, self-esteem comes from doing esteemable things. It's not about sitting at home waiting for the government to give you another check because you just had another child out of wedlock. It's about education. Back in the late 1970s when Jimmy Carter decided we want to take education out of housing, wealth, education and welfare and create it as its own separate agency. The initial budget for the Department of Education back then was about $18.1 to $18.2 billion. Go home, do your research. What's the budget for the Department of Education today? Now ask yourself, what has happened to the standards of education in the United States of America? You know, isn't it very interesting that the first black president, and everyone cheered, everyone loved, the black community came out in droves. He was the man in April 2009 to cancel the DC school voucher program. But his kids, who were sitting with our friends, do as I say, not as I do. That's the liberal progressive way. Because the liberal progressives, because they think the government should not be limited. They think that there should not be fiscally responsible. They don't believe in the individual and their sovereignty. They don't believe in the free marketplace of ideas. They believe in the equality of outcomes, not the equality of opportunity that allows me to stand here before you all today. That's the difference. And that's what we have to tell people.
Now, I can talk to you about policies,
tax policy, regulatory policy. I can talk to you about how we should move away from baseline budgeting to zero-based budgeting and have your federal spending under control.
The American people don't care about that, really. The American people want to know that you care about them, not about anything. The American people want to know that you want to promote their success. The American people want to know, I want to get back to work.
The unemployment rate is not 5.4% in the United States of America. There's no way that the unemployment rate can be dropping and the workforce participation rate is dropping along with them.
Tell the American people about that.
Find one of those 93 million Americans that have been completely dropped out of the workforce. No one is even counting them anymore because they do count. Go into the black community. Go into the Hispanic community. Go into all these minority communities. Because truly, the essence of minority communities, they're conservative. On Sundays, the most conservative people in the United States of America are black. Trust me on that. If you go into a church, they preach to conservatism. Now, something happens Monday through Saturday. Okay? We got to talk to them about it. Because we got to tell them. The first black members of the House of Representatives and the Senate were Republican. The first black civil rights legislation, 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments, that was done by Republicans. Segregation, Jim Crow, literacy tests, poll tax, lynchings. That came from the original party of segregation, the original party of slavery, the original party of secession, the party today of Marxist socialism, progressive socialism. The party that gave us 50 years ago the Great Society, which is failing abhorrently. But if we don't tell them those simple things, the only message they hear are the messages of Barbara Lee in Oakland, Maxine Waters down in South Central LA, Sheila Jackson Lee in Houston, Eddie Bernice Jackson, Johnson, I don't know, whatever, in Dallas, Texas. If those are the only messages they hear, if the only message they hear is of that charlatan Al Sharpton, then they will never know the true blessings of the dream that the man who was born and raised in my neighborhood, Dr. King, had. Now, limited government, fiscal responsibility, individual sovereignty, free market, free enterprise system, all of those things are great. But if we don't have a strong national defense to secure America and protect our people, none of it means anything. America was a very prosperous nation on 9/11, 2001, when those planes flew into buildings. We have an enemy that is not at the gates. We have an enemy that is in the gates. And we must stand strong and resolute to defeat this enemy. This is an enemy that has been fighting against Western civilization, as Joel talked about, for almost 1,400 years. You should trace it back. Dig up Charles Martel, who defeated them at the Battle of Tours in 732. Talk to the Venetian sailors at the Battle of Lepanto in 1571. Talk to the Germanic and the Polish knights at the gates of Vienna in 1683. This is just a new chapter in an ongoing battle for freedom and liberty against probably one of the most vicious, vile, and violent ideologies that the world has ever known. And if we don't have men and women on Capitol Hill and in the White House that will clearly identify this enemy, then we're not going to be successful. If any of you have ever read the book, The Art of War by Sun Tzu, where it says you must know your enemy, you must know yourself, and you must know the environment. And if you know those three things, in countless amounts of battles, you will always be victorious. We're not going to be victorious because we refuse to identify and understand who the enemy is. Yet they tell us every single day on social media, Facebook, Twitter, and what have you. They are going in and they are taking our young people and they're radicalizing them right before our eyes. And if we don't stand up and take this fight to them, then it may be a difficult fight. When you have the leaders of the Gulf Cooperation Council, they say to the President of the United States of America, we're not coming for your summit. We're tired of talk. It's time for action. When you have our own Secretary of State sitting at a table right across from Vladimir Putin is looking at him like, are we done yet? And in the post-meeting conference, our Secretary of State says, we had a very productive meeting. We decided that we will meet again and talk some more. That's not how we protect America. The number one responsibility of the federal government is to provide for the common defense. It can be done in a fiscally responsible manner, but we must provide for that common defense and not seek to provide for a general welfare, which is how we have the priorities of the federal government upside down. I want to close by saying this. This is a challenge. This is probably the most challenging moment. Someone stood in 2008 and said, we're 5 days away from fundamentally transforming the United States of America. And the thing was that people clapped, people cheered, people welcomed that. And you know why? Because we stopped telling the story of America. We have allowed the other side to get into our schools and not educate our children, but indoctrinate our children. I need you all to be the adult. I need you all to take back your homes, to tell your children that it's my house, it's my rules. And when they bring their friends over, you talk to those friends and you tell them the story of America. You tell them about what you believe in. If those kids come over to visit your kids and they sit down and have dinner with you, you pray over that meal. Because a lot of times these kids don't even hear a blessing. You got to start being the adult. You have to start being the one that is in charge. And most importantly, you have to go out and find people that don't believe as you do and courageously make the stand. Find five people and get three of them. Because that's 60%. And if you look at most of the polls out there, 60% of this country knows that we're heading in the wrong direction. They just need people to talk to them. What was the beauty of the governor of this great state, Ronald Reagan, our president, was that he was a simple, concise communicator. And he told great stories about this great nation. He was an exemplary example of American exceptionalism. That's what this country needs. Now, I know y'all are sitting around, y'all probably gonna ask me, why don't you run for this or run for that or do this or do that or whatever, okay? I ran this morning, I put in 4 miles, yeah? But this is what I want to share. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 through 6, it says, trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not upon your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. I didn't like losing that congressional race in 2012. But for whatever reason, God wanted me to be here with you right now in this moment to give you this message. That's the most important thing. If he wants me back up there, he'll put me back up there. But for right now, I have to do as paratroopers have always done. Wherever your feet land, you fight. And so as I depart here, I ask you one simple thing, that you fight. Because there's a simple epithet that's at a place called Thermopylae. Many years ago, 490 BC, and it says this, go tell the Spartans and strangers passing by that here, obedient to their laws, we lie. That was the code of Lycurgus, the code of the Spartans. It should be the code of the American that each and every one of us should have as the epithet over our gravestone so that our children will always remember that my mommy, my daddy, my grandma, my grandpa, they fought so that I could be free. God bless you all. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Joel's going to have the questions for us. Thank you.
See, that was a lot on this one little car. All right. Where's my teleprompter? It's invisible, it's hidden. Yeah.
All right, the questions are gonna come from over here.
Okay.
Over on your right. And we've got ushers walking around with blank index cards. If you have a question you wanna pose, raise your hand, you'll get a card, you can write it down, please write legibly, and they'll bring it over to me.
You know they don't even teach cursive anymore, can you believe that?
God. Yeah, just tweet your questions to me. All right, I'm going to kick things off before I get any to start us. I'd like if you could talk about religious liberty, and especially in the context of the religious freedom measures that are being debated in the states. And about forcing bakers and florists to participate in ceremonies that are contrary to their faith.
This is very important. I mean, first thing we need to understand is when you hear people talk about separation of church and state, you need to immediately ask them to show you where that's written. Because most people can't. You know, this just has become a buzzword that everyone is using now to get us to, you know, eschew our Judeo-Christian faith heritage. Notice I said faith heritage, I did not say religion. But the whole concept and idea about separation of church and state was not in the Declaration of Independence, it's not in the Federalist Papers, it's not in the Constitution. It was a simple idea that Thomas Jefferson wrote in a letter to the Danbury, Connecticut Baptist Convention, where he talked about here in the United States of America, we would not have a head of state who was also the head of church. And the whole purpose behind separation of church and state was that we would not have religious persecution. We would not have a state that would persecute people because of their religious beliefs. Now, fast forward 230 some odd years, and guess what we have? We have persecution of people based upon their religious beliefs. You know, we cannot get to a point where we believe that the personal lifestyle choices of an individual all of a sudden trumps a First Amendment right, which is freedom of religion and the free exercise thereof. And the other side has twisted this to the point where they're trying to throw in, you know, discrimination or whatever. But if a person says, here, I have this business, I'll bake you a cake, I'll do it, but I don't want to participate in this event, to have the state, to have government come in and, you know, penalize people and persecute people for that, that is about as anti-American as it can get. And we need to be able to stand up for religious freedom, because remember, one of the mantras of socialism is the creation of a secular state. And if we get to the point where we're driving the persecution of people's religious beliefs, it's incredible to me. Now, let me talk to you about the hypocrisy that is out there. There's a certain group of individuals that, if you draw a cartoon of the prophet, I guess some people believe that you should die. If you all of a sudden in Minneapolis, Minnesota, at Target, there are employees there that say, we don't want to touch and scan any pork or bacon products. And they're allowed to do that because of their religious belief. There are cab drivers that will not allow people to be picked up in their cab if they have a seeing eye dog or if they have alcohol that they bought in a class 6 store. Now, explain this to me, Lucy. Why is it that their religious beliefs are accepted, but yet ours are, as Judeo-Christian heritage? So that's where we have this argument that we should clearly make. Why is it that taxpayer dollars are being used to make foot wash stations? That's not right. So I think that on the basis of fact, we win this argument, but we have to once again be strong enough to stand up and make it so. Because this is very dangerous if we start to lose that freedom of religion and the free exercise thereof. And let me give you a last point. I'll close on this. I went to the University of Tennessee. One of the great traditions at the University of Tennessee is that before every home game, a local pastor is invited to give a prayer before that football game. I graduated in 1983. I went back this past year for the Tennessee-Alabama game. They're still doing it. But you know that there's a group out of Wisconsin called the Freedom from Religion Foundation, which is oxymoronic. They actually sent a letter to my alma mater telling us to cease and desist having prayer before a football game. This is how emboldened the other side has become. If there's a silent majority, y'all need to take off the muzzle.
All right, I got to warn you, I'm piling up a pretty good collection of excellent questions here. So,
well, we got till 8:15.
No, we got till 2 in the morning.
All right, well. Kidding. I don't think y'all can hang.
All right, this one you may have partially addressed already. I was busy reading some questions while you were answering, so apologies if it's a repeat. How do we stop the advance of Islam in this country?
Well, let me tell you, the first thing you have to do is, I mentioned with Sun Tzu, you know, when the president in August of last year stood up and he was going to give us his grand strategy of how he was going to defeat the JV team, and he said, let me make myself very clear, something along the lines, ISIS, perfectly good, ISIS is not Islamic. Now look, you got to tell me, are they Episcopalian? Are they Presbyterian? You know? Are they Catholic? They're not Mennonite? I can Okay, they ain't Southern Baptists because I had never heard them shout hallelujah. But if that is the tone that you have coming from your commander-in-chief, then you're not going to be successful in defeating this enemy. If you are standing there as the commander-in-chief of the National Prayer Breakfast right after you've seen the horrific burning of that Jordanian pilot, and you say to this gathered crowd at the National Prayer Breakfast, you Christians need to get off your high horse, because you did the same thing during the Crusades. Well, he kind of forgot to tell us why Pope Urban II called for the Crusades in 1095. That's because Christians were being attacked by Muslims in the Holy Land in the first place.
So, if you look at the policies, you look at the statements of President Obama, don't go out there and say he's a Muslim. You can't prove that, okay? And the only thing that does is that allows the other side to attack you. But if you go out and say that based upon his policies and his statements, President Obama is an Islamist sympathizer, that's the truth. So it's going to be very hard to defeat this enemy until we get a commander-in-chief that's willing to identify this enemy.
All right, switching topics just a little bit. Which of the cabinet departments do you think most need to be eliminated or drastically overhauled?
Now I gotta be very careful. I don't have a Rick Perry moment here.
Well, one of the things I think we need to do is we need to go back and we need to look at the last great expansion of the federal government and go forward from there. And that was during the Carter administration. So when we look at, you know, Department of Education, everything that's been created since that point in time, that's where we need to make the start. You know, one of the things that they teach you in the military is when you show up to a new duty station, the first thing you read is the mission statement of that unit. And then you get to understand, you know, what their task and what their purpose is. I think that if we sat down and looked at the mission statements of most of the cabinet agencies up there, we asked her that very simple question. Are they meeting their mission? You know, the Department of Energy was created to make the United States of America energy independent. That's one. I think that when you look at the Department of Homeland Security, I mean, when the Secretary of Homeland Security is on a Sunday show and all of a sudden, we got a real problem with the domestic terrorism and jihadism. Well, no, you know what, Sherlock. So, I mean, is the Department of Homeland Security, you know, fulfilling their intended mission and their purposes? And yes, you look at education, you look at energy, you look at the Department of Agriculture. We're not an agrarian society anymore. Sure, we still have the Central Valley and other places, but America is not an agrarian society. And furthermore, when you look at the farm bill, 80% of the farm bill is food stamps. It has nothing to do with agriculture. So why do we have a Department of Agriculture if only 25% of the bill that authorizes its appropriations and its allocations deal with agriculture? It's insidious. It's insane. So those are the type of things that we have to look at. And I believe that if we had leadership that sat down and logically looked at the growth of the administrative bureaucratic state and said, we got to get this under control. You know, regulation is hidden taxation, folks. And the fact that you have people, bureaucrats, that are writing rules and regulations that are costing you money, that's wrong. That's supposed to go through your elected representatives. So those are the type of things that we should be able to do, and I think that if we made that logical analysis, the American people get it. Remember what I said, limited government. If government is limited, it's fiscally responsible. If the government is fiscally responsible, it respects individual sovereignty because it returns all those resources back to you. And when those resources come back to you, we can have true economic growth and opportunity and prosperity because you know how to invest, you know how to create through innovation, you know how to use your own ingenuity.
You talked about black Americans possessing conservative values. How does the GOP successfully communicate with and reach out to that community?
They just got to do it.
I mean, the next time Reince Priebus, the chairman of ROTC, comes out in California, y'all need to sit down and ask him, what's his strategy? What's his plan? Because if you go back tonight, I want you to Google, bring up the 2012 presidential electoral map. And look at all that red. And then look at the little bitty splatters of blue. See, because the other side has broken this down to political calculus. In 2012, President Obama won 27% of the counties in the United States of America. But that gave him close to 330 electoral votes. How many electoral votes do you need to win? That's why they say it was a landslide. And now you look at all of those counties, what are all those counties centered around?
Urban areas.
Urban areas. Where are the most minority communities?
Urban areas.
In urban areas. Where's the most failure in the United States of America?
Urban areas.
Now, I'm from Georgia. I went to the University of Tennessee. I'm not a rocket scientist. But it seems to me that's where you want to focus on. And it seems to me that's where you want to tell your story. You know, it was amazing to me that finally, Chris Wallace, a couple of Sundays ago, challenged Donna Edwards, who's a representative out of Baltimore, congressional representatives, and he asked her, do you think that Baltimore is a reflection of the failure of liberal progressive policies in the inner city? And she couldn't answer. And he kind of let her off the hook instead of going in for the kill.
Think you need more money?
Well, yeah, they need not limited government, not fiscal response. Go up to Oakland. Look what is happening in Oakland. That's where we have to go to make the case. Now, I'm standing here. Am I trying to say that you went over the entire minority communities? No. But if we were to win 15% in a national level election of a black community, if we were to win 35, 40% in a Hispanic community in a national level election, you just sunk the other side's battleship. And when you talk about faith, when you talk about family, when you talk about education, when you talk about service to the military, because our military is very heavy with blacks and Hispanics, those are conservative principles and ideas. You know, I shared at a little gathering before we came here about when Mayor Bill de Blasio wanted to cancel the charter schools in New York City. He wanted to get rid of them. One of the most successful schools in New York City is a charter school in Harlem called Success Academy. And who are the people that complained to Governor Cuomo about what Mayor de Blasio wanted to do? Single black mothers who realized that this was their only hope to save their child from the cycle that they had gotten caught up in. Now, why aren't we championing in the inner city charter schools, school choice, school vouchers, homeschooling, all of those alternatives? Because the other side can't talk about that because the teachers' unions will kill them. That is how, you know, I hate the word outreach. If any of y'all ever stand in front of me and y'all say something about outreach, I'm going to kill you. Okay? And let me explain why. Because this is what outreach means. Outreach means you show up in Black History Month and you have some fried chicken, mashed potatoes, collard greens, cornbread. You go to a church, you try to get some rhythm and sing with the choir, and you're all out of beat. And then they never see you again until 2 months before the election. And it's kind of like Jesus said, be gone for I know you not. If we are going to win in these communities, that means we have to have policy inclusiveness. That means that we have to go there, and we have to stay there, and we have to talk to them about the things that are important in their lifestyle, in their lives, rather. You know, I think it was 2008, Proposition 8, the marriage amendment out here. You know why that was not successful? Because in 2008, you drove out the black community. And the black community is conservative in nature. They believe in marriage between one man and one woman. Remember that I said most conservative people on Sunday in the black church. Same thing happened in Florida. Same thing's going on in Michigan right now. The greatest challenges to Michigan changing their constitutional ban on same-sex marriage has come from black ministers. That's how you have policy inclusiveness. Don't show up for one specific month, have some chow, and then leave. Continually talk to them. Are there any black churches in San Jose? Are there any black churches in Santa Clara? How many of y'all have a partnership between white churches and black churches? Okay? That's how you start to break these things down. Because that's the greatest commonality, is our religious faith and belief. Next.
All right, I'm going to combine a couple of questions here. You said that the Constitution's purpose is to limit government. Is it doing that today? If not, what do we do about it? And where do you stand on a convention of the states?
Look, the Article 5 Convention of the States is in the Constitution. The Founding Fathers put it there for a reason, because they believed that if the federal government would not act within their proper constraints, and that includes the respective branches, being the executive, the legislative, and judicial branch, he enabled the people to be able to do something about it, to the states. This is a system of federalism, where the states have the power in these United States of America. So with the Article 5 Convention, let me make sure I got my math right, I believe that it would take 34 states to be able to bring a constitutional amendment to the legislative branch. If you get 38 states, that means that you have a constitutional amendment that can bypass and it goes right in. That's what we need to do. I think one of the first two constitutional amendments that the states need to impart, number one, term limits on federal legislators, number two, a balanced budget amendment on federal legislators. The second was a balanced budget amendment. Most of your states have balanced budget amendments. I think you need that. Let me tell you what happened. I remember voting for the balanced budget amendment up there when I was in Congress, and because you had to have the two-thirds majority vote in the House, we didn't achieve the two-thirds majority vote. And there were people on the House floor that actually cheered and clapped because we did not pass a balanced budget amendment. That's not good, okay? Now, the other thing is that there is an incredible abdication of the enumerated powers of the legislative branch. Why? I don't know. But I can tell you this, that every single person at the last State of the Union address that stood up and cheered and clapped when the president said that I have a pen and I will take my own executive action without the legislature, if they cheered and clapped that, then they need to go home. Because that means that they do not want to be up there and they do not want to be representatives of the American people. Okay? We have checks and balances. We have a system of co-equal branches of government, okay? And we need to stop having legislation from the bench. There are some cases that are going before the federal Supreme Court that just don't need to be up there, okay? So I think that we really need to have a serious constitutional conversation in the United States of America. And we need to have someone that when they put their hand down, they say that they're going to support and defend the Constitution, they know what that means. We need to get more people to serve in the military up there on Capitol Hill.
All right, I'm not going to make you answer this one, but I just want to point out I've got several cards here that are basically from people who would really love to see the name Alan West on a ballot.
There are already going to be like 20 of them on the stage. You don't need 21, okay? We'll see. Oh, no. Don't take that wrong. No. Hey, time out, coach.
All right, Freddie's the
death ballot. That's
okay. Right. How can a bad agreement with Iran be prevented, or is it too late?
I think it might be too late. I hate to say that. And hats off to Senator Tom Cotton.
I mean, that's truly what that's why you need to have people that have served in the military.
Because an Army Airborne Ranger stands up and says, I'll be the only no. I have no problems with that against you other 98. You know, why are we sitting down and going into negotiations to have a nuclear deal with a country that's holding Americans hostage?
Yes.
I mean, why are we sitting down and talking about having to deal with a country that's the number one state sponsor of Islamic terrorism? Now, everyone is saying, hey, you know, they won't be able to maybe get a bomb until 15 or 20 years from now. I'm 54, man. I may still be kicking. But our children and grandchildren will be around. And the other thing that we have to come to consider is that all of a sudden we're talking about relieving those sanctions on them, which means, you know, billions of dollars that will come flowing back into their coffers. Where do you think those billions of dollars are going to go? They're going to go to Hamas, they're going to Hezbollah, they're going to go to all these other groups, they're going to go to the Houthis. You know, every single major
you know, incursion of Islamic terrorism, you can probably find Iran's fingerprints on it. This is, it's amazing, it's unconscionable to me. This is, if you know your history, this is a Chamberlain-Hitler moment. Okay? And, you know, someone's going to come back and say, you know, I have a signed document from the Supreme Leader, Ayatollah Khamenei, that there will be peace in our time. And remember that Adolf Hitler took the Rhineland and didn't fire one single shot. And when he saw that, and he was asked about that document that he signed, you know what his response was? It's just a piece of paper. That's what we're setting up for. See, that's why we need to teach history. Not that revised history crap that Common Core has. We need to teach real history.
Under Hillary Clinton's watch as Secretary of State, she and Obama.
Everybody got any Tylenol?
She and Obama allowed 20% of our uranium to fall under Russian control. Isn't this treason?
Look, you know, it's so much. I mean, Libya, Benghazi, I mean, I can go ad nauseum ad infinitum. The world is a far more dangerous place. And, you know, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, she was part of this incredibly degraded global security environment in which we find ourselves. And it's, you know, Marcus Tullius Cicero called it the arrogance of officialdom. For people to believe that they are above the rest of us and the rule of law, you know, I don't want to be bothered with having email like everyone else. So I have my own private email on my own private server in my own private residence. Here are the emails that I will give to you. And oh, by the way, I've destroyed and erased everything off the server. And no, you can't come into my house and get the emails. Hello, McFly. That's the property of the American people, you know. We need to be able to talk to the American people and tell them these things. I mean, you know, have we gotten to the point where character means so little that this is what we're willing to accept? And see, this is the whole part about identity politics, one of the historical moments. We want the first black president, and we dropped the bar so low. We want the first woman president, and we're dropping the bar even lower. And then after that, it's going to be the first Hispanic president, and we'll take Julian Castro, whose mother, I'm serious, have y'all seen this guy, the former mayor of San Antonio? His mother is the, you know, head of this leftist Hispanic group. And then what comes after that? That's what we're all after, a historical moment. And oh, by the way, we don't have a leader. We don't have any person of character. It's all about historical moments. See, American Idol, this is their final season. American Idol is going to continue on in 2016. It's called a presidential election cycle. But that's what we have become. And it is, if there's anything that does cause me concern or worry, it's us. It's what we are willing as a nation, as a people, to accept. Now, we've got to be able to go out and say, there's a better way than this. You know, I think it was Benjamin Franklin said, sometimes you get the government you want, other times you get the government you deserve. You know, 7 to 8, how many people out here call themselves Christian? Okay? 7 to 8 million of us did not vote in 2012. And now they're sitting around saying, oh, Hobby Lobby, oh, you know, they're going, they're persecuting Christians, whatever. Well, guess what? Where were you in November, that first Tuesday in 2012? Okay? I know you say, where is your candidate? But ma'am, please don't do this again. And tell your friends, don't cut off your nose to spite your face. Okay, at least have a person that you can have a seat at the table with. We cannot sit this one out. Next cycle. Next.
Do you have any insights from your time in Congress, and in particular, were you particularly encouraged or discouraged by anything you'd want to comment on?
You know, a kid born in the inner city of Atlanta, Georgia in 1961.
got to grow up to command a combat battalion in Iraq. He came from a dad who was a corporal in World War II. The greatest moment in my life was to wake up every day and go for my morning run and run past the United States Capitol in the early morning light. When there's no one out, it's just quiet, serene. And to know that your entire life was dedicated to the service of defending the principles and values that that Capitol stood for. And then the greatness of this country is that you got the chance to be inside that building and continue your service in a suit and tie. See, that doesn't happen anywhere else but in these great United States of America. And see, that's the simple message that we have to tell people. You know, when I listen to the commencement speech that Michelle Obama gave at Tuskegee University. Now, this is what was so very disconcerting about that. The person that started Tuskegee Institute, Booker T. Washington, was not about victimization. He was about three principles, three-point agenda: education, entrepreneurship, and self-reliance. He did not believe that the black community, even living under the specter of Jim Crow and segregation, had to see themselves as victims, had to see themselves as not being able to have an equality of opportunity to achieve whatever greatness that they wanted. And to be at this point in 2015, for that to be said at that incredible institution, I know that Booker T. Washington was turning over his grave. But the sad thing is that most people don't know who Booker T. Washington is. And so when I think about the great days that I had, I saw, you know, horrible things up there. Lying, deceit, whatever. I saw, you know, lobbyists being able to, you know, manipulate people for votes. But every morning when I woke up and ran past our nation's capital in that early morning light, damn, there's something special about that. There's something special about us. And that's what I need you all, again, to tell that story about why we're special. And why this other side, who wants us to be like everybody else, we're not like everybody else. America is about everyone can be a one percenter. Everybody can be a champion. You know, I find it very interesting that San Francisco is one of the most liberal cities in the United States of America. Seattle, up the road, is one of the most liberal cities in the United States of America. But they surely do cheer for these teams to be champions. The Giants, the 49ers, the Golden State Warriors, the Seahawks. Why don't they cheer for their country to be a champion?
Pam Geller's act of defiance is criticized by the left and the right as provocative. Would you please comment on this misunderstood act of bravery?
Hey, look, where I live in Dallas now is about 20 minutes from Garland, Texas, where that incident occurred. I think it is absolutely shameful. I think it is disgusting and despicable that anyone in the United States of America would attack Pam Geller and not attack the Islamic jihadists who wanted to kill her. Okay. There are no buts on free speech. And I have a saying that I tell people: when tolerance becomes a one-way street, it leads to cultural suicide. If we get to the point where we are so afraid of a certain group of people because they have anger management problems, then we will lose our country. And the fact that we see people that are trying to use coercion, intimidation, and fear to get us to submit to their belief, and let's be very honest, the word Islam means submission. That's not who we are as American people. You know, I will stand here and tell you that Muhammad was a murderous warlord. And that's fact. Okay, he led somewhere between 30 to 33 combat raids starting in 622 AD with the Nakla raid. He ordered the beheading of an entire Jewish tribe, the Banu Qurayza, in 628 AD at the Battle of the Trenches. There is the sword of Muhammad, which has a Quranic verse over it, which is the flag of Saudi Arabia. Now, if my saying that offends people, then get the hell over it, okay?
Now, some of y'all may know that, you know, I recently wrote a post on my personal website about the chairman of the Palm Beach County Republican Committee, who he's concerned about dirt builders coming and speaking. And look, not everyone can be, you know, a warrior like Pam Geller and myself. And so, you know, I told him, if you are concerned about, you know, the safety and security of people, which you cannot have total control over, you know, you may need to think about, you know, not having that event. But we cannot allow them to believe that they can win by intimidating them. Just the same as we see in Baltimore with that state's attorney, Ms. Mosby, who basically is trying to adjust the law and justice being defined by the mob. You know, we cannot allow the mobocracy to take over. Pamela Geller has the right to free speech. And if the right to free speech is to draw someone, and I don't get it. I mean, what's the big deal about drawing, you know, a picture of a guy who's been dead for a long time, okay? But again, it's about us. And it's about us surrendering to the other side. We can't do this. Because remember, this is something that's been going on for 1,400 years. And the Taliban had a saying that I hope you all remember. They used to tell us, you all may have watches, but we have the time.
Can you share any examples of progressive ideas that were once implemented and then reversed?
You know, it's very hard. As a matter of fact, if you were not paying attention to the news today, Elizabeth Warren and Mayor Bill de Blasio came out with a progressive socialist version of a contract with America. And if we get that $15 an hour minimum wage out there, it's gonna be hard to reverse that. You know, and small business owners are either gonna put more people on unemployment rolls, gonna put more people on part-time, they're just gonna go out of business. You know, we should not have that where they should be the ones trying to dictate it. And you know, think about what the minimum wage is for a young private, or a young second lieutenant, or a young warrant officer. Is it more important that the French fry guy at McDonald's get $15 an hour? Or is it more important that we take care of the person that enables us to meet and have this great meeting here tonight? So I will have a piece that will be out on townhall.com tomorrow about income inequality, and I think you'll enjoy it because we do a comparative analysis of pay scales. It's very hard to turn back a progressive policy because, as Rush Limbaugh said, it's really hard to win against Santa Claus. But the thing that we have to tell folks is just the same as Margaret Thatcher once said. The inherent problem with socialism is that you eventually run out of other people's money. Okay. All right, we got what? About five more minutes, huh?
Yeah.
Am I boring y'all? I don't know if I'd sit there and listen to me, so.
All right, a couple more and we'll wrap it up. Got a couple of questions here. Let me combine them. Does the Democratic Party cheat in elections?
I almost spit my water. Do you know who you're asking that of? Hey, let me tell you my story. You know, St. Lucie County in 2012. At 1 o'clock in the morning, you're sitting there and you're ahead by 2,000 votes. At 1:05 in the morning, you're behind by 2,000 votes. And they were never able to explain it. And even the supervisor of elections in St. Lucie County, you know, where they incredibly had like 114% voter turnout. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed, but I thought it was 100%. And you can give 110% effort, but I don't know about 114% voter turnout. Of course there is. And we have to be very concerned about these driver's licenses that are being given to illegals because, you know, as we are going out talking about picture ID, what is going to happen when, you know, someone shows up with a picture ID? Okay. You can't win on ideas. They can't. They have to win on deception. They have to win on coercion. They have to win on intimidation. And even if not that, I mean, we heard the president come out and say that he's talking about having mandatory elections now. Because they saw in a midterm election cycle, when it was about his policies, it was not about him being on the ticket, he couldn't inspire people. If there's not the American idol that they everyone focuses on, that identity politics, they can't win. They can't inspire folks. So we have to be very cognizant of there's a difference between midterm election cycles and presidential election cycles. Midterm election cycles are about intellectual policy. People understand it. You guys get it. We come out because we understand the value of the legislative branch. But presidential election cycles, it's a popularity contest. Might as well be a prom. And that is what they're going to continue to try to exploit. And there are two phases to a presidential or a national level election now that we have to be cognizant of. It's an image phase and it's a message phase. No one can beat us on the message phase unless we refuse to deliver the message. But what we continue to lose is on the image phase. And if we don't win the image phase, we don't draw people to this persona, this charismatic individual, then we're never going to get to the message phase. And that was what Ronald Reagan was able to do. He was able to win an image phase. And then he was able to just, you know, destroy you with his very simple, easy message. I mean, he tore Jimmy Carter apart. He tore Walter Mondale apart. 49 out of 50 states. We don't win by trying to be a lesser version of the other side. But if we could create a clear delineation that Ronald Reagan did in his re-election against Walter Mondale, he won 49 out of 50 states. The only state that never voted for Ronald Reagan was Minnesota. And I understand, you know, Viking people, I mean, I don't know. I mean, they voted for Jesse Ventura and Al Franken. There's something wrong up there in Minnesota, man. Okay, so I'm sure the Gipper is running around saying, well, you know, it's just Minnesota. So it's no big deal. But 49 out of 50 states, and he ran as a true constitutional conservative. Think about this. We're jumping around happy that we get 169,000 new jobs in a month, or 200,000 new jobs in a month. Go back and look at Ronald Reagan's job creation numbers in his 8 years. There were months when he hit a million new jobs in this country. We can't accept this new normal. And that's truth, that's fact. But we gotta have a charismatic persona that we get the attention of the American people, and then we went on that message. I don't know, who's that guy?
All right, just a couple more here.
You already had a black guy president. You ain't gonna have no one. He's ruined it for all of us black guys. That will make someone's YouTube moment. Be president. It's true.
I think you just picked up another 100 votes, actually. Could you talk about the resettlement of refugees throughout the United States?
Horrible thing. Okay. I am very concerned about that. I was recently in Nashville, Tennessee. Governor Bill Haslam has even sent a letter to the president about this resettlement of the Syrian Muslims into his state. And then also the chairman of the House Homeland Security, Mike McCall, Representative Mike McCall, has expressed his concern about it. I got a simple question. Who are the people that are really being persecuted in the Middle East? Why are they getting resettled back here? Okay. They're the ones getting crucified, getting beheaded, the women are being raped. So, you know, I got a big concern about this. And
go home tonight, read about this thing called the Hijra, H-I-J-R-A. And that was one of the principles of Muhammad that said that the means by which you can further and spread Islam is through migration. And that is what he did when he left Mecca in 622. He went to Medina and he started the next phase of Islam, which was the beginning of the more violent phase. And you see that happening in Europe. You know, very, very, I mean, Geert Wilders can talk to you about what's going on in the Netherlands. You see it happening in places like Australia. So I'm very concerned about this this population influx.
All right, before we get to the last question, I just want to acknowledge we had some great questions tonight. I've still got a stack of probably 20 fantastic questions that we just don't have time for. So I'm sorry if your question isn't one of the ones that we had a chance to ask Colonel West. But this last one, again, I'm going to combine from several. If you're going to deprive us of the opportunity to vote for Alan West, a lot of people were asking who you would endorse in 2016. I'm not really going to expect you to answer that, but bring it around to the notion that a true conservative is unelectable and we need to nominate a moderate.
I don't think that a true conservative is unelectable. I don't believe that. I believe that if the American people have a clear choice, they will vote for that which is best for growth, opportunity, prosperity, and the protection of this great nation. They will vote for someone that represents American exceptionalism and the restoration of, you know, our constitutional republic. Now, I will tell you that it's very early. We've got six people that have declared. You probably will see another five to six between now and the end of June, and then maybe a couple more before we have the first debate in August. But this is what I want you to think about. This is the prism that I am evaluating, you know, the next, you know, presidential nominee from our side on. Who is the person that can sit in a room with Hassan Rouhani, Xi Jinping, the leader of China, Vladimir Putin, any other despots, dictators, theocrats, and autocrats in this world, and make them wet their pants? That's what I'm looking for. And on that very happy note, I bid you farewell and thank you so much.